study them. This is entitled The Life and Ministry of John Wycliffe. In order to understand this a little bit, I will say a few things concerning church history, and that is that the study of church history up until the 14th century focused on the Roman Empire, the gradual tyrannical rise of the Romish papal system, and the darkness that covered Western Europe. Throughout that period, though, the gospel continued to go forth through the lives of individual Christians. Although the gospel's power may have seemed very small and very insignificant during that long period, it was still in perfect harmony with the eternal redemptive purpose of God. God had not failed. The gospel had not somehow failed. It was in perfect harmony with the eternal redemptive purpose of God. The principles of saving faith were still at work during the Dark Ages, as it was revealed, and as it is revealed in Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, when Paul said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written," or as it stands written, "the just shall live by faith." People have been saved the same way ever since God ordained salvation for mankind. No matter how bad things were, the gospel was going forth to the lives of individual Christians, through preachers, and through small churches wherever they could be found during the Dark Ages. In the beginning of the 14th century, God ordained that a great shining light appear on the horizon. It is the first time in over 1,000 years that a significant light was to shine upon the land. It illuminated the darkness that had so permeated the land for millions of lives for over a millennium. God ushered in the dawn of the Reformation. In those early morning hours of that darkness, a great light appeared on the horizon, and that light was the light of the gospel that God had ordained, and he used that man by the name of John Wycliffe. He is the morning star of the Reformation. He brought forth the great shining light of the gospel in all of its glory for all to see, and it had been hidden to most people for over 1,000 years. The early life and times of John Wycliffe were a time of great tumult during the time of the Dark Ages. Wycliffe was born somewhere between 1319 and 1324. No one knows for exactly sure. He was born in the region of Yorkshire in a small town named Wycliffe. While Wycliffe was growing up, The influence of the papacy was at its zenith. The Pope John the 22nd decreed to be called our Lord God the Pope. He had great wickedness in his life, and he demanded that people call him God. The power and excesses of God of Rome during this period was graphically illustrated through the lifestyle of a Roman bishop in Winchester named William Wykeham. He owned 50 manors throughout England. Imagine one powerful man having 50 estates throughout England. This man did. This was how powerful Rome was in England. The common man in England was in bondage to Rome and its sacraments, and they exploited sin and the penalty for sin and kept people in bondage because they feared for their souls. The common payment for remission of sins was payment to the priest to get yourself out of purgatory or to pay for your sins. They were constantly exploiting the superstitious mind of the people of the day in order to gain wealth, and they were unremitting in doing this. Also, during this period of time, you need to know that England and France were at war. The Pope's seat was in France, in Avignon, outside of Paris. And England was very, very weak at this period of time. The common proverb at Avignon was that the English were like docile asses bearing all the burdens heaped upon them. Much like, well, we'll stop there. We need to talk about Oxford for a moment. Oxford University was the most influential university in the known world at the time. It was ruled by the university graduates who were Dominican monks, and they were the Black Friars. They made it their work to undermine the laws of Oxford and of England, all the while applying the laws of Rome to England herself. They sent out traveling pardoners throughout the land to sell pardons for sin to all the people that were enslaved to Rome. If a man died without a will, Rome immediately confiscated all of his holdings, and his family was left without anything. The Rome would take their money, their home, their assets, whatever they could get their hand on. They were very, very, very powerful people. During this period of time, in the early 14th century, Rome owned 50% of the real estate in England. We need to talk about Wycliffe's education at Oxford. Wycliffe was no doubt the most brilliant man of his time. He entered his studies at Oxford at the age of 16, which was common for young men at the time. By the way, if you want to know where the word bachelor comes from, the word bachelor of science, bachelor of arts, you are not allowed to get married until you finished your education at Oxford. And so you were a bachelor. He first entered Queen's College and then Merton College. And Merton College was the most prestigious college in all of Oxford. At that time, 30,000 students went to Oxford University. He earned the title, the Flower of Oxford. Consider being given the title, the Flower of Oxford, when you are one in 30,000 people. He achieved the status of Master of Philosophy at the university at age 40. He earned his bachelor's degree at age 33, which was average for people. So they went to school for, 17 years before they got their bachelor's degree. He went on to get his master's at age 40, and I think 5 or 10 years later, he was one of the few to earn a doctorate from that university. There was a man that preached to the Oxford students. He was the Archbishop of Canterbury. He was a saved man. His name was Thomas Bradwardine. Now, he was converted while at Oxford, and he gave it his life goal to preach the gospel to the students at Oxford. And he also preached the doctrines of grace. Once he was converted, he rejected the doctrine of Pelagius and embraced the doctrines of Augustine and promoted the doctrines of Augustine to the monks at Oxford. He also brought the gospel in its most simple form so the monks could understand. Remember, these people were in darkness. They did not understand the Word of God. They weren't taught the Word of God. They didn't read the Word of God. And Bradwardine was able to go there and open up the gospel to them and preach Jesus Christ to them. And people were converted under his ministry. Well, under his influence, Wycliffe intellectually came to understand and believe the doctrines of grace, although he was not converted when he came to the doctrines of grace. But he did read the Latin Vulgate with great joy, and he loved the influence and the friendship of Bradwardine. What is next important in the life of John Wycliffe is the Black Plague, the great Black Plague that swept over Europe, came when John Wycliffe was about 25 years of age. It came from Asia with lice, I think, on the backs of mice, and of course by ships. The ships landed in Europe by way of these rats in 1347. On August 1st, 1348, the first ships landed in England. And on November 1st of that same year, the plague had hit London itself. When it was over, three years later, in 1351, an estimated 100,000 people in London had lost their lives to the Black Plague. It was a horrible, horrible thing. An estimated 45 to 50% of all the people in England and Europe lost their lives during this great Black Plague. England and Europe were completely struck down. Dead animals littered the land, mass graves were dug, industry was stalled, farms were no longer in use, and Parliament was closed. Terror, mourning, superstition, and death reigned over all of Europe. Many believed it was God's judgment for allowing Jews on the land. Strasbourg murdered 2,000 Jews, believing God would cleanse them of the plague if they rid themselves of the Jews. By 1351, there was an attempt to exterminate the Jews from the face of Europe. From more than 200 small towns and cities across Europe, there was an extended attempt to exterminate the Jews from the land, hoping that God would bring blessing through this murder. Well, this plague had a great, profound effect on John Wycliffe. Two-thirds of the people that grew up in the town that he lived, that he was raised in, and in the areas surrounding his town, died. So it was a very, very, very tough time for him, obviously. D'Aubigné, commenting on the plague's influence over the soul of Wycliffe, said, "It sounded like the trumpet of Judgment Day in the heart of Wycliffe. The combination of Bradwardine's preaching, Wycliffe's reading of the Bible, the Holy Spirit working in his life, no doubt, and the terror of the Black Plague brought John Wycliffe to Jesus Christ as a lost sinner in need of a Savior. The Word of God became his guiding light. It opened up his heart to truth and to salvation, and he came to believe that it needed to be preached and applied to his generation. It was his life's goal from that moment forward to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to all that would hear." It's important also to understand the relationship that Rome had to the Bible during this period of time, because it wasn't easy to preach the gospel during the Dark Ages. It wasn't proper, it wasn't allowed, in fact, it was unlawful. As Wycliffe developed his theological mind, he increasingly became aware that the doctrines of Rome were at variance with the doctrines of the Bible. Through that profound devastation of the land and the great mourning people of the land, Wycliffe understood that he was in a great position to preach the gospel to a very needy people. He seized the moment, no doubt about that. As a Calvinist, Wycliffe understood and realized that his position and influence at Oxford did not happen by chance. He knew, he understood, that he was ordained by God, placed in this position to preach the gospel to a people that were starving for the truth of Jesus Christ. He also understood through remarkable wisdom that he needed to take things slow. Remember, the world had been in the Dark Ages for 1,000 years. You couldn't just come right out and just speak loudly. He started to take things slow, little by little, easing people in to the truth of the gospel. If he didn't, he would soon be silenced as a heretic and taken away and be murdered. The world had been in darkness much too long for him to make a mistake in this area. It would take time for him to ease people into these reforms. He first started to engage his own colleagues in conversation and debate concerning the Bible. He then developed a survey of the Bible itself. He studied the Bible and he started surveying the Bible. This is the Old Testament. This is the New Testament. This is the five books of Moses. These are the historical books. These are the poetical books. These are the prophetic books. These are the Gospels. This is the book of Acts, the historical account of the Gospel marching through. And these are the pastoral epistles. These are the prison epistles. And this is the book of Revelation. He literally started out like that and explained the Bible in a very, very easy format. He lectured on them to the students at Oxford and the faculty. And of course, these things were very beneficial to him, and he educated himself along the way. He then began debating the Black Friars. He did this on doctrinal and practical issues. He started to attack the medieval church of Rome by exposing the doctrinal errors and the immoral vices of the Black Friars of England, of Oxford. In 1360, Wycliffe wrote a treatise called Objections to the Friars. Now, this was a direct assault upon the leadership of the most influential university in all the world. They were known as begging friars, who took from the people and offered nothing. They preached against sins and took from the people their money and offered them nothing in return. They completely enslaved these people. And Wycliffe brought all this to light. They refused to work and were constantly seeking ways to extort money from the common peasants who lived in fear of Rome. The friars obviously approached Wycliffe and demanded that he stop attacking them, but Wycliffe persisted. In fact, he was relentless, and through his efforts, he gained great favor with the common man in the region. The mask was pulled away from the Catholic monks who were exposed for all people to see. His desire was for doctrinal reform, and he soon found himself in the forefront of a political battle that would change the world forever. No one could see this great significant act, but this was about what was about to happen. We need to go back 150 years for just a moment to really understand what's going on at this period of time. It's now about 1365. I want to go back 150 years to the beginning of the 1200s. In England, of course. During the reign of John, King of England, he was a very weak and vacillating king. Pope Innocent III sat on the throne of Rome at the time. The Inquisitions were raging all across the land in Europe against anyone who named the name of Christ. And they also were raging against kings and princes who were required to bow the knee to Rome. Innocent III decided that he was going to appoint his own priest to be Archbishop of Canterbury. Now, that was unheard of. That's only the King of England could do that, and Innocent from Rome said, no, we are going to place our own Catholic man in the Archbishop of Canterbury. Well, and he also said, I claim this right for all time. Well, in a moment of defiance, John declared the Pope's nominee should never occupy the Archbishop's chair. Sounds good, doesn't it? Well, he did his best at that moment to fight off the brutality of the Romish doctrine. John then deposed all bishops and abbots from the country, expelled them all from the land. Well, after a two-year battle, things got pretty tough. The Pope struck back and encouraged France to attack England, in which they did. On May 15th, 1213, that coward, King John, recanted his oath to protect his country. Unbelievable. He surrendered his kingdom and gave the throne to Innocent with an added promise to pay Rome 1,000 marks per year as a vassal state under Rome. And if that wasn't enough, John went to France, bowed his knee to the feet of Innocent III, took off his crown, and gave it to the Pope. This was the greatest humiliation that England had ever endured. 2 years later, the barons of England had had enough. They were outraged that this had happened. They went to John and they demanded that England fight Rome to regain their sovereignty. The king cried, "I will not grant you liberties which would make me a slave." The man didn't even know he already was a slave. Very, very sad situations. Well, to make a long story short, the barons forced King John to sign Magna Carta, the great doctrine of England. The document revoked the king's vow to be a vassal state under Rome and took back the kingdom which he gave away. Magna Carta was a document demanding liberty and freedom from tyrannical despots. England was ready to fight for that liberty, and they did. Now we're back where we started from in 1365, and we can understand the place and influence of John Wycliffe. 150 years later, Pope Urban V attempted to reassert supremacy over England. He says, "I want you to now give me that 1,000 marks per year, and you are now going to be a vassal state once again." Urban declared that the Pope, as the vicar of Christ, the spokesman for Christ, was the supreme lord over all earthly kingdoms. England had not forgotten the humiliation that she had endured under King John, and stated through one of her generals, "The kingdom of England was not won by the sword, and by that sword has been defended. Let the Pope gird on his sword and try to exact this tribute by force." England believed that her only road to victory and sovereignty was by the sword, but they were mistaken. God intervened and revealed the sword of the Spirit, which was the word of God. God raised up a lowly monk to defeat the great superpower of the earth, Rome, and he did that through a lowly monk by the name of John Wycliffe. During that same year, Wycliffe was appointed head of Canterbury Hall, a new college inside of Oxford, and he became the head of that college. Then he became one of the king's chaplains. In the providence of God, Wycliffe became the voice of England because he became the king's chaplain. Wycliffe reasoned thus: "There cannot be two temporal sovereigns in one country. Either Edward is king or Urban is king. We make our choice. We accept Edward of England and refuse Urban of Rome." He declared that England did not have the right to obligate themselves to a foreign leader. He declared on behalf of Parliament, "The Pope of Rome had no right to require the King of England to collect money from the Church of England and then be sent to Rome." This was out and out warfare to declare this from Parliament against Rome. Rome, for 1,000 years, had crushed anyone that spoke like this. Well, the battle begins, obviously. It began against the great superpower of the earth. The eyes of all Europe were now on England, and John Wycliffe was the voice that excited great anticipation, the anticipation of finally being emancipated from the dark satanic kingdom of Rome. Would the morning star of the Reformation be extinguished, or would the light of the gospel and liberty advance upon the land? No one knew. At this time, the long and bloody road to the Reformation had begun. No one could really grasp the significance at this moment, but it had begun. Wycliffe was appointed by the king to be lector at Lutterworth, and he gave himself the title, the king's peculiar clerk. He preached at Oxford and London against the Pope's sovereignty over the nation. He went from place to place, I quote, barking against the church. He then wrote a tract and declared the Bishop of Rome, the Antichrist, the proud worldly priest of Rome, and the most cursed of clippers and cut purses. Then a bill for Parliament was issued that stated that God hath given his sheep to the Pope to be pastored, and not shorn and shaven. No papal collector should remain in England upon pain of life and limb. And no Englishman should become such collector or remain at the court of Rome. Wycliffe was the chief architect of this document. It means you could not stand there and be a tax collector for Rome in England, take that money and take it to Rome. And if you rose up as an English citizen and did it, then you were an enemy of the state, much like the publicans during the time of our Lord. Wycliffe became a friend and hero of the king and the common Englishman. In contrast, of course, he was hated by the clergy and monks who ruled over Oxford. He criticized the black friars for their indolence, habits of begging, and the perversion of the scriptures. The price for his boldness had now become due. It was determined by the Pope and his minions that Wycliffe must be destroyed. Fox wrote this: "The whole glut of monks and begging friars were set in a rage or madness which did assail this good man on every side, fighting for their altars, paunches, and bellies. After them the priest, and then after them the archbishop, took the matter in hand." Wycliffe's writings were then examined and condemned. Wycliffe wrote that the Pope had no power than ordinary priests, that princes cannot give payments to Rome. If gifts to Rome are abused, then they can be revoked, and that Christ gave no temporal lordship to the Pope. After he wrote that, there were three papal bulls executed against Wycliffe. On May 22, 1377, these bulls were sent to England, which urged the immediate steps be taken to silence this dangerous heresy. This dangerous heresy, I want to remind you, was the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Pope condemned Wycliffe as a master of errors. He chastised the English clergy for allowing that man to spring up on their soil. The Pope decreed that Wycliffe was to be shut up in prison, and proof of his heresy was to be secured until further instructions were given. The real purpose, of course, of the bulls was to establish an Inquisition in England and take Wycliffe back to Rome, kill him, in order that Europe would be kept in satanic darkness. They had to shut him up. The only way for them to stay in power was to extinguish the light of the gospel in the land. And his voice was getting louder and louder as the days, weeks, months, and years went on. They knew that it was essential that Wycliffe had to be stopped. He was then put on trial. He had four trials. His first trial was February 19, 1377. Wycliffe was summoned by the bishops of England to stand before a convocation at St. Paul's to answer before his inquisitors. Rome's motive was for John Wycliffe, the loudest voice for the gospel in almost a millennium, to be silenced for good. That's all they cared about. This was not a true court. This was a kangaroo court to murder John Wycliffe. Rome attacked him without mercy, but the king and the parliament stood by his side. He was accompanied on that day by the Earl Marshal of England and the Duke of Lancaster. They understood the stakes were high, not just for Wycliffe, but for all of England. And so they stood by him during this period. They represented their country well, and they demonstrated great resolve against Rome. In fact, they knew that it was not just about Wycliffe and England. They knew it was all about Europe itself. It was now quite clear what the stakes were. The crowds were inside and outside of St. Paul's. They were immense. The court could not establish order because of the crowds were so incredibly excited about John Wycliffe being set free. It was so bad that at 9 a.m. in the morning, the inquisitors stopped the proceedings and John Wycliffe went home. Wycliffe had become the hero and champion for life, truth, and liberty in the midst of a kingdom of darkness, and the crowds recognized that. Wycliffe was the epicenter and the voice for the truth of the gospel, and all knew it. No man had come on the scene like this in 1,000 years. Amazing, amazing man. As time went on, Parliament grew bolder against Rome. Wycliffe as the voice of Parliament succeeded because he always based his arguments on the word of God. And the common man intuitively understood what he was saying was true. Common men understand it more than anybody else. In essence, Wycliffe convinced the king, Parliament, and the common man that their rebellion against the tyranny of Rome was not sinful, and they would not incur the wrath of God. Remember, for 1,000 years, if you spoke against the church, if you did anything contrary to what Rome said was right or wrong, you were going to be punished eternally. Wycliffe was able at this point to calm everybody and say, no, it's okay. The Bible, the scriptures are our standard for truth and liberty, not Rome. And they were comforted that they were right in that. In fact, he also told them they would not only not incur wrath, but they would incur blessings from God if they obeyed God rather than man. Well, a year later, they put him on trial again. And he did this, though, as a national hero. He was going to call to appear before a primate in April of that year at the Palace of Lambeth, just across from Westminster Abbey. The goal of the Romish court was to put Wycliffe in irons, remand him to the dungeon, and simply have him disappear forever. No radio commentators, no tapes, no news flashes, no newspapers, nobody. There's nothing. It's just over. It's gone. Forgotten. That's what they wanted to do. But once again, the loving crowds came to his side. They surrounded the palace. Not only that, before the trial started, the Queen Mother of England sent a letter to the court forbidding the court to pass sentence upon Wycliffe. Walsingham said this: the effect was dramatic. As the wind of a reed shaken, their speech became soft as oil to the public loss of their own dignity and the damage to the whole church. They were struck with such dread that you would think them to be as a man that heareth not, in whose mouth are no reproofs. Wycliffe then took the opportunity to make his cause known to all that were present, and he simply walked out of the courtroom without being touched. And then he put all of his defenses in writing. I want to read a very concise statement about all of his defenses. I've written them down in 9 points. Number one, he wrote, the Pope's spiritual authority is not absolute. Number two, popes have no power over kings. Number three, popes may fall into sin as other men do. Four, priests have no power to absolve men of their sins or the power of anathema to curse men. Number five, excommunication from the Romish Church does not place the souls of men in danger. Six, priests are to be bound to preach the gospel, not compel their subjects to pay tithes. Seven, the real estate in England, owned by Rome, again, 50% of the real estate of England, was ill-gotten and not lawful. Eight, England had the right to confiscate the land from Rome. And last, nine, the Pope was a man of sin who exalted himself above God. This was very, very powerful. Wycliffe's only standard for judgment was the Word of God. He could find nothing in the scriptures to back the claims of Rome. Sadly, the fight was too much for most to handle. The fight had been going on longer than people wanted to, and their resolve to fight Rome began to wane. Private and public support for Wycliffe began to diminish. Well, after this, Wycliffe decided it was time to start translating the Bible into the English language. After this trial in 1378, he began that most momentous work. He took the Latin Vulgate, word for word, and translated the Latin Vulgate into the English-speaking language. Southern Europe had already had the Romaic version. Some people had parts of it or a little of it, and they could read the Bible, but very few had it. But Wycliffe was about to give the Word of God to the English-speaking people. In 1382, 4 years later, he completed the translation of the English Bible. One man said Lutterworth was a beehive of excitement and an evangelistic exercise. There were probably hundreds of workers during that period copying the new translation as fast as he could write it. They were printing them out as many as they could get out, so they could disperse them across the land. Many of these men were scholars from England who were converted under his ministry, and many were common people who were converted under his ministry. They were called the Wycliffeites. Others joined the cause known as the Lollards. Wycliffe's works was immediately condemned, of course, by Rome. Archbishop Arundel said, "This pestilential and most wretched John Wycliffe, of damnable memory, a child of the old devil, and himself a child or pupil of Antichrist, crowned his wickedness by translating the scriptures into the mother tongue." Isn't that amazing? That the Rome was so perverted in their thinking that a man of God that wanted the Bible given to a common man was considered demon-possessed. Amazing. The archbishop prohibited the work to go further and decreed that all the books would be burned. For close to a millennium, think of this, for close to a millennium, Rome kept the world in darkness by prohibiting ownership and reading of the Word of God. Through the work of Wycliffe, the common man, the common woman, and the common child could read the Bible for themselves. Wiley said this, "What an epoch in the history of England. What mattered it when dungeon or a grave might close over him? He had kindled a light which could never be put out. He had placed in the hands of his countrymen their true Magna Carta." In 1381, a year before he finished his Bible, we're going back a year now, Wycliffe suffered his first stroke. The friars from Oxford rushed to his side, knowing that he was about to die, and they tried to force him to recant of his errors. His response was clear: "I shall not die, but live again to declare the evil deeds of the friars." He recovered, of course, and the most important part of his ministerial labors were about to begin. In 1381, he assaulted the Romish doctrine of transubstantiation. Now, that was a very, very bold move by Wycliffe. This is something that the rest of Oxford just simply could not handle. He sent out 12 different challenges to debate the issue. He sent 12 challenges to debate the issue. And all you could hear through the walls of Oxford was, "Wycliffe is a heretic. Wycliffe is a heretic. He has denounced the doctrine of transubstantiation." He said, "Then come and debate me. We will debate the issues. We will decide what they are." No one took up the cause. They were quick to count him as a heretic, but nobody could prove it. In 1382, he was condemned by the Chancellor and Council at Oxford, and he was threatened with imprisonment, suspension, and excommunication if he did not silence his claims against transubstantiation. Wycliffe demanded they show him his errors. Of course, they could not. He was soon after expelled from Oxford, and the politicians, of course, at that point began to walk away from him. They had lost their resolves, and England was in great peril once again. Now, as for his third trial, he's weak, he's alone, very few people are standing by him, except, of course, God himself. And we have the Blackfriars Synod called the Earthquake Council. On May 17, 1382, Wycliffe was brought to trial at the monastery of the Blackfriars in Oxford. His judges were 8 prelates, 14 doctors, 6 bachelors of divinity, 4 monks, and 15 friars. As the proceedings began, a great earthquake shook the land so great that the big blocks from the building fell down, the steeple fell down, and people could not believe it. The pinnacles literally toppled from the building. Still, the council condemned his writings. Wycliffe called it a judgment of God, and it was dubbed the Earthquake Council. The Chancellor of Oxford wrote to King Richard II, and he said this: "If we permit this heretic to appeal continually to the passion of the people, our destruction is inevitable. We must silence the Lollards." The king gave the chancellor authority to imprison anyone who supported Wycliffe. His Oxford friends, of course, grew very weary of well-doing at this point and deserted him. Wycliffe, of course, remained steadfast. 2 years later was his fourth trial at Oxford. He was summoned to Oxford to answer for his claims against transubstantiation for the last time. Wycliffe declared this: "With whom think you are contending? With an old man on the brink of the grave? No, with truth. Truth which is stronger than you and will overcome you." With that, he turned and left his enemies stupefied. D'Aubigny said, like his divine master at Nazareth, he passed through the midst of them. Just walked out. Amazing. They were so overawed with his power and his presence and his authority as a man of God, their mouths were shut. Well, after this, England's resolve to support this man and to support the cause of their own country diminished. England no longer desired to fight for liberty and freedom. John Wycliffe was abandoned by the king. His Oxford supporters recanted, and Oxford was once again a vassal of Rome. Wycliffe went into retirement at Lutterworth. He was banished from his beloved Oxford, never to return. It seemed the Reformation was crushed. All his stately friends had left him. But we still have his most glorious years ahead of him. All is lost, and yet not in God's eyes. The glorious moment and time of his life is now about to begin. The time of evangelizing the world. All the work had been done. All the books had been written. The Bible had been translated. His main supporters, Christians who were converted under his ministry, were working next to him, and they were now ready to preach the gospel in that dark land. Rome, of course, at the same time, seized the moment. Indulgences were extended to the dead once again. Masses were given all over England again, and superstition enslaved the people. But Wycliffe was still at work. He wrote his most important theological treatise at this time, the Trialogues. It stated the principle that where the Bible and the church do not agree, church meaning Rome, that where the Bible and Rome do not agree, we must only obey the Bible. And where conscience and human authority are in conflict, we must follow our conscience. We must deal with Wycliffe's Bible men, the Lollards. Wycliffe spent his remaining years preaching, teaching, and training men to preach the gospel. His students were known as poor priests who had once been ordained by the Church of Rome. Wycliffe taught these men how to live. They were not allowed to beg, and they were to work for all of their needs. He taught them how to preach and how to think theologically. His great concern was the exposition of the Word of God. He taught them how to open up the text and preach it easily, understandably, to the common people. He also taught them that preaching was the primary means God used for the salvation of sinners. Wycliffe understood that the Word of God would reveal the light of men to that generation and beyond. He knew the gospel could go way beyond his life and theirs. In the words of Kenneth Connolly, he taught them how to reproduce. And last, he taught them how to die a martyr's death. He was teaching these men to preach the gospel in a land where it was illegal to preach the gospel. These men, the Lollards, were easily spotted by all. They were shoeless. They carried a staff in their hand. They wore long, rust-colored robes down to their bare feet. And they also carried portions of Wycliffe's Bible in their long, deep pockets. These men carried the light of the gospel to every corner of the land. They preached in churches, in churchyards, in open squares, in marketplaces, in homes, and on the street corner. Wherever they could, they preached the gospel. Their converts were so many that Bishop Knighton complained of the Bible men that, quote, like their master, they were too eloquent, that they're mighty in words, they exceeded all men in making speeches. He also complained, every second man you meet is a Lollard. They were soon to be persecuted for their faith. Well, it was time for Wycliffe to leave the scene. Before Wycliffe was to die, he was summoned for a fifth time to stand before the prelates. This time, he was to stand before the Pope in Rome. He wanted to go. I think like Paul the Apostle, he wanted to stand before Caesar, but he was old and he was very sick, and he wrote them a letter declining that he simply couldn't make the trip, but he wanted to make it. On December 29, 1384, he was about to dispense with the Lord's Supper in his church, and he suffered a third stroke. He took him to his home, and 2 days later, he died. So what is the greatness then? What is the influence of this great man? Well, the greatness of John Wycliffe is found in his character. That's where it's found. It's not in his intellect. It's not anything. It was found in his character. He lived what he believed, and he practiced what he preached. It's that simple. More than any one thing, Wycliffe relied on the word of God alone for his faith and his practice. Through his instruction and influence, the Lollards continued the work that he began and did it the way he taught them how to do it. Well, persecution raged in England after the death of Wycliffe. In 1401, the law for burning heretics was once again passed. If you were caught with Wycliffe's Bible, it was chained around your neck, and you were burned along with the Bible in front of a large crowd. In 1428, in a last attempt to destroy the influence of Wycliffe, his bones were exhumed, they were burned, and they were dumped in the River Avon, which is right next to Westminster Abbey. Thomas Fuller illustrated the influence of Wycliffe this way. He said, the little river Swift conveyed Wycliffe's remains into the Avon, Avon into the Severn, Severn into the narrow seas, they into the main ocean, and thus the ashes of Wycliffe are the emblem of his doctrine, which now is dispensed the entire world over. After they did this, the Lollard trials began in 1430. Actually, we're going back a little bit, but that's all right. In 1430, the Lollard trials began. It was a capital offense to copy the Bible, to read the Bible, or to hear the Bible being read. Capital offense. That means it puts you to death for listening to the Bible being read to you. In 1518, Thomas Mann was burned alive. His crime? He preached the gospel as a pastor. 700 people were saved under his ministry, and for that he was put to death. In 1521, 500 Lollards were arrested and tried at St. Paul's in London. Then they were burned alive at Smithfield. Today you can go to Smithfield and see where they burned these people. Hundreds were condemned in Essex and Middlesex, and the place of execution was called the Lollards Pit, which you can still see to this day. They had in their possession Wycliffe's Bible and his writings. Even 150 years later, they were reproducing faster than they could be exterminated. So many were being killed that the secretary of Henry VIII wrote a letter to Erasmus stating that wood had grown scarce and dear because so much was needed to burn the heretics, the Lollards. Today, you can go to Lambeth Palace. You can see the Lollards Tower, and you can see Smithfield for yourself. And lastly, we'll deal with the extended influence of John Wycliffe in closing. Wycliffe truly was the father of the Reformation. He had no predecessor except the forgotten millions of martyrs who had shed their blood because they would not forsake their Lord Jesus Christ. Many died before him. Many stood for Christ. But no one had the power of the pen, the power of the pulpit, and the power of Parliament like White Wycliffe. And yet, millions went before him. Wycliffe believed, preached, and trained men to preach the gospel. He believed in justification by faith alone. He believed in the authority of scriptures. He believed in the sovereignty of God. He believed in the doctrines of grace. That means that he rejected the doctrines that were dominant in the area, in that era of Pelagian doctrine, and he welcomed the doctrines of Augustine. He believed only in two church ordinances. That means he rejected all church sacraments of Rome. He only believed in the Lord's Supper and believers' baptism by immersion, just like the Baptists did, and just like the Bible teaches us. It was because of John Wycliffe that liberty was eventually established in England. Through the moral constitution of the law of God that was given to the people, England never again submitted themselves to a foreign leader willingly. The seed of the principle of inherent human rights was planted by John Wycliffe. His influence could not be extinguished. Jerome of Prague went to Oxford and got his writings, was converted through the writings of John Wycliffe, translated them into the Bohemian tongue, took them back to Bohemia, where a great revival broke out in Bohemia. His good friend John Huss read the writings of Wycliffe and was converted. Through his great influence, the Great War broke out, and Rome tried and won to extinguish the gospel in Bohemia. Huss was killed. After Huss, of course, Martin Luther came on the scene, and then Zwingli, and then Calvin, and then John Knox, and then the English Puritans, and then the Scottish Covenanters. And in the end, the gospel of grace, the gospel of liberty, and the gospel of freedom landed on the shores of America. And it started with this man. It started with all the martyrs that fought for liberty of conscience, for freedom to believe what they wanted to believe, no matter what the cost, and to serve their Lord, even if it meant burning at the stake. Most importantly, though, we must understand that it is the gospel of Jesus Christ through the lives of believers that secured liberty of conscience and a missionary spirit during the time of John Wycliffe. The regenerating work of the Spirit of God compels us to obey God rather than men in the dictates of religious conscience. No tyrannical government or power has ever in the history of the world successfully stopped New Testament Christians from obeying the primary ordinance of the church. And the primary ordinance of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ is to evangelize the world for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. John Wycliffe, the morning star of the Reformation, is one of the great icons and illustrations of the power of God through the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is through the gospel that freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and soul liberty of conscience has been established in Europe and in our land especially. These inherent rights are embedded in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and John Wycliffe and all those who lived and died for the gospel has secured that great freedom for us for what they did. They paid the great price for the great liberties that we so enjoy today, or take for liberty, I should say. So that little sketch of this man's life is all I have, and I hope, hopefully, it's kind of gives you an essence of the life of John Wycliffe. And with that, we'll close.
Amen. Thank you, brother.